Is the pain in your foot, hip, or leg keeping you from walking as far as you used to? Medical reporter Catherine Pratt examines a new treatment Monday on the Channel 2 News at 5.
Hey, Chicago, come on down.
The Price is Right, television's most exciting game show, where you can win up to $15,000 at home.
Hello, Mrs. Valdez. Mrs. Valdez, this is Bob Barker.
Play The Price is Right, weekdays at 3.
At Dominic's Save on Coke, 8 16-ounce bottles of regular and caffeine-free Coke and Diet Coke, just $1.09 through Wednesday at Dominic's.
And now Dominic's can save you $3 on the regular ticket price at Six Flags Great America. Enjoy all of the rides, all of the shows, all of the thrills on the amazing new Z-Force. All for $3 off the regular Six Flags Great America price. Only at Dominic's Finer Foods.
Donahue explores androgyny Monday morning at 9.
Hey, Kessler, what's happening?
Guarantee of ultimate stability and no furloughs, etc., is profitability and a vibrant company. That's the only ultimate guarantee, because as we all know, there ain't no Santa Claus.
3 years ago, when we proudly announced the acquisition of Eastern Airlines, at a press conference, I never believed that we'd be here today.
Now that the battle has moved into the bankruptcy courts, what could happen next? Lorenzo could try to do with Eastern what he did with Continental, abrogate union contracts. But it won't be that easy this time.
Under the old bankruptcy law, you could automatically abrogate labor contracts. Under the new law, you must petition the bankruptcy judge, and he has to render a ruling whether you can abrogate labor contracts.
What about selling off some of Eastern's assets? That, too, would be up to a bankruptcy judge.
It's entirely possible that a particular sale of aircraft or routes or slots on a piecemeal basis will be objected to, and the court could rule that that type of transaction, even if otherwise beneficial to raise some cash or what have you, cannot be done except as part of an overall reorganization.
From the union side came calls for an all-out war on Texas Air, Eastern's parent company.
We are calling on every possible force in this country that has any conscience, including the flying public, to be sure that Frank Lorenzo and this atrocity that he has perpetrated does not succeed.
Finally, what would it mean if Eastern Airlines were to go under? For the traveling public, it would obviously mean one less airline to choose from and the near certainty of higher airline fares. And for the unions? One less employer, more people looking for work, and the near certainty that they would find work either at lower wages or not at all. I'm Jeff Greenfield for Nightline in New York.
A little later in this broadcast, we'll be joined by officials of the Machinists Union and the Airline Pilots Association, as well as a senior executive with Eastern's parent company, Texas Air. But first, when we come back, we'll talk with a former federal bankruptcy judge about the consequences of today's action by the airline.
This is ABC News Nightline, brought to you.
A cop, mentally disabled by the violence he faced. Now the police, he claims, won't give him the pension he deserves. Watch 2020 Friday.
Eastern could take several directions when it goes into bankruptcy. Present management may keep control, but whatever it does must be approved by the court. Chairman Frank Lorenzo says he expects a smaller airline to emerge. TWA Chairman and Corporate Raider Carl Icahn says he's been contacted by Eastern unions and is willing to talk about buying the airline if Eastern's management permits it.
John Flowers is a former federal bankruptcy judge for the Northern District of Texas who presided over the Braniff Airlines bankruptcy proceedings back in 1982 and 83. Judge Flowers, who currently heads the bankruptcy section of a Dallas law firm, is with us now in our Dallas bureau. Help us out from the simplest level, first of all. If I am an Eastern customer and I bought tickets to fly down to Florida, let's say, a couple of weeks from now, what happens? Do I get my money back?
Ted, I'm afraid you don't. Ticket holders, prior to the filing of the bankruptcy, he had a right to ride on an airplane furnished by Eastern. Upon the filing of the bankruptcy by Eastern, they were made into unsecured creditors, and they will stand in line like all other unsecured creditors, although Congress has provided a limited amount of protection for them.
So they just lose everything, or is there a chance, let's say, that another airline might be willing to accept those tickets?
Well, another airline might choose to accept their tickets, but it would be a voluntary act on the other airline's part. Some airlines may choose to do so, and some may not. There would be some incentive for an airline to fly Eastern's passengers. They may want to obtain some of Eastern's customers, build goodwill for themselves, improve their competitive edge. Others may choose not to. In the Braniff case, for a period of time, there was some confusion, and some airlines were honoring Braniff's tickets, and others were not. Ultimately, I think none of the airlines honored the tickets.
Look into Frank Lorenzo's mind for a moment right now, and I realize that you can't say with certainty what he is about and what he is doing. But what are the advantages that he gains? I mentioned that at the top of the broadcast, he gains some time. What else does he gain?
Well, I think by filing bankruptcy, Eastern has gained some things. The first and most obvious is that interest on their unsecured debt stops running. Another is that...
What does that mean? Forgive me for interrupting.
Creditors to whom Eastern owes money that have an agreement whereby Eastern is to pay them interest, unsecured creditors can... no longer collect interest on their indebtedness upon the filing of the bankruptcy. The interest stops.
Okay.
Eastern, of course, was holding a large amount of money representing ticket sales for future rides on Eastern's aircraft. As you know, the trend today is for airlines to sell tickets for future flights and give discounts. So a great deal of money is accumulated by Eastern in that fashion. Those customers have a right prior to the bankruptcy filing to demand refunds. Now that the bankruptcy has been filed, they are turned into what we call pre-petition unsecured creditors, and they have no right, specific right, to the specific monies that they have paid to Eastern for those tickets.
Judge Flowers, forgive me, because we still have an awful lot to do tonight, and we'll come back a little bit later in the broadcast and talk to you also, but I just want to ask you, as a former bankruptcy judge yourself, when you have the responsibility as a judge to make the decisions or to decide which decisions can be made, doesn't that put you in the position of being a businessman rather than an interpreter of the law?
In some respects, a bankruptcy judge is making business decisions, Ted. But by the very nature of the process, bankruptcy anticipates that businesses will reorganize, and the way the law is structured, the judge is simply going to have to make some business decisions.
I guess what I'm asking is it the tendency of a judge to sort of defer to the businessman if the businessman comes in and makes a compelling case that he can sort of reorganize if he is allowed to do A, B, C, and D? Does the judge tend to go along with that?
Not necessarily at all. And these matters aren't presented in a vacuum. Opposing parties will present their experts who will give views that will assist the judge as well as the management, and then the judge has available to him expertise from all sides of the issue from which then he can make his decision.
So just very quickly, what Frank Lorenzo has done today then is a little bit of a gamble. He gains some, but he may lose some.
Oh yes, very much of a gamble.
All right, Judge, we'll be back to you a little bit later. Thank you. When we come back, we'll be joined by the head of the striking machinists at Eastern, by an official of the Airline Pilots Association, and by a senior vice president of Texas Air, Eastern's parent company.
Moms on the road, first class, or driving a truck. What it's like when a job requires leaving the kids behind. Watch 2020 Friday.
Supplying drug addicts with free needles. Tomorrow, a continuing controversy in the fight against AIDS. Also, Arnold Schwarzenegger on Good Morning America.
Charles Bryan is president and general chairman of District 100 of the International Association of Machinists and is chief negotiator for 8,500 Eastern mechanics, baggage handlers, and other ground employees who are out on strike. He is with us in our Miami bureau. Captain J. Randolph Babbitt, who is with us in our Washington Bureau, is a veteran Eastern pilot and executive administrator of the Airline Pilots Association. Also here in Washington, Clark Onstad, senior vice president of Texas Air Corporation, which includes both Eastern and Continental Airlines. Captain Babbitt, I'm sure you were listening to the news conference this morning when the announcement was made of Chapter 11. It sounded to me as though Mr. Lorenzo totally ignored the machinists and spent all his time going after the pilots. Can you imagine why?
No, Ted, I cannot. We're simply honoring in the trade union tradition a picket line set up by a union on this property. This is a confrontation that has been brewing for a great deal of time, and we're simply honoring that picket line.
Well, let me suggest, I mean, I think you're being a little disingenuous. I mean, they can fly without the machinists, perhaps, but it's awfully tough to fly without the pilots. Isn't that what's getting in his craw?
Well, that's absolutely correct, but those machinists have been unable to resolve this dispute that they have with Texas Air Corporation. They genuinely have tried every avenue, every peaceful avenue available. They accepted binding arbitration. We, in fact, intervened as the Airline Pilots Association and requested that the president of the country, following on the recommendation of the National Mediation Board, actually appoint a presidential emergency board. That would have been a peaceful resolution of this dispute.
Why now? I mean, you and the machinists didn't always get along this well.
Well, they have. This is a little different time for us. Quite honestly, this management has been provoking this confrontation, we believe, since we came on the property, or since the management itself, Texas Air Corps, took Eastern Airlines over in February of 1986. We were somewhat surprised, optimistic that President Bush would, in fact, invoke the authority vested in him under the Railway Labor Act and put forth and set a presidential emergency board. He is the first president, I might add, since the Railway Labor Act's inception, 62 years, that didn't follow the recommendation of the National Mediation Board.
Let me get over to Charlie Bryan for a moment. If Frank Lorenzo went after the pilots, you folks have been going after Frank Lorenzo as though he were the issue. Is he really the issue here, or aren't there some more objective things that can be debated or negotiated?
Well, Frank Lorenzo is the issue, not as a personality, but simply because of what he does. I really don't like the idea of personalizing this and so that it looks like an ego or personality event.
Well, you sure done that, though. I mean,
well,
folks have been targeting Frank Lorenzo to a failure.
Absolutely, because he's been the guy who's led the parade of all of this activity we've been exposed to and the abuse of the employees. I'd like to comment, if I could, Ted, about the comments of the bankruptcy judge made earlier. It's very curious that he said that the tickets would not be honored and certainly didn't have much value at this point because of the bankruptcy filing. You know, a ticket is basically like a loan to the company, and then that loan gets paid back when you fly the trip. They call it air traffic liability, and almost $300 million of Eastern's cash was tied up in that kind of liability, which they were trying to protect, obviously, at the expense of their customers who paid for those tickets. And ironically, the employees have been put in the same boat because they declared this bankruptcy on payday, and even though they've worked and earned their money, the employees are not getting checks that they were entitled to this week. So now I'm wondering, and I'd be very interested in the bankruptcy judge's comments on it, I'm wondering, since the enormous amount of assets and cash and resources and airplanes and routes have been transferred from Eastern Airlines over to Continental, I'm wondering if the whole Texas Air Empire and Continental will not be exposed by the bankruptcy court to this bankruptcy, and perhaps their tickets, that loan that you're making to Continental, will be treated the same way.
Judge Flowers?
Well, this is very early in this proceeding, and it's premature to speculate about what might happen regarding Texas Air. There are, of course, provisions that non-debtor parties might be brought in and held responsible for the debts of a debtor, but the requirements of that are quite stringent, and I believe it's too early, and a great many more facts need to be developed before that would be something that we could talk about.
All right, I'll tell you what. Mr. Onstad, who is here representing Texas Air and by extension Eastern, is eager to get into this fray, and we'll let him do that as soon as we continue our conversation, which will be in a moment. Continuing our conversation now with Clark Onstad, who is a senior vice president of Texas Air, which includes both Continental and Eastern Airlines. Let's pick up for a moment on that $300 million that the traveling public has lent Eastern Airlines in the form of ticket sales, advanced ticket sales.
I'm glad we finally got to let the carrier talk about that subject, Ted, because there's been a lot of misinformation tonight, and people have forgotten a very important precedent. First to understand, we didn't expect to be in bankruptcy a week ago, so not all the decisions have been made. However, at Continental Airlines, we went into bankruptcy. We took care of all those tickets. We offered people the opportunity to fly on Continental, and in fact, we got to the point where we gave them two tickets for one ticket that they held pre-bankruptcy.
But you had an ongoing airline there.
As we will with Eastern.
Well, that's still open to question.
Continental came back from a total shutdown of 2 days, didn't even fly the first 2 days, unlike Eastern, which had been flying limited from Saturday.
Fact of the matter is, the longer that Eastern stays out, the tougher it is ever to bring it back, isn't it?
However, that's true, but next week we will operate our full South American schedule. We'll operate a full shuttle, and based upon the number of pilots who called in today and indicate they're prepared to come to work and cross the picket line, I think you'll see even more flights in the air next week.
When you say you're going to be operating the full shuttle, how many flights a day is that?
Ted, it is 15 round trips Boston, New York, and 15 round trips New York, Washington.
So how many pilots do you need for that? And are you saying you've got them already, or are you just presuming you'll have them?
No, sir. That shuttle is operating on time and full operation today. I flew it today, Ted.
I mean, you've got all the pilots. I thought you were saying you were only going to be flying that next week.
Oh, no, I was just giving you next week's schedule. We are flying the shuttle today. We are flying limited South America. Next week, we bring up all of South America except Caracas, plus continue to operate the shuttle next week.
Now, we were talking about $300 million, though, in outstanding loans to the flying public.
That's right, and it took a while.
The loans are the other way around, loans from the flying public to Eastern Airlines.
And it took a while to work them off in the... In a Continental bankruptcy, but a lot of these tickets have been taken care of by other carriers. Continental has carried a large number of people. Delta's carried a large number of people, and other carriers have carried a large number of people. So, $300 million is a very misleading figure at this point in time, Ted.
Where is it that Frank Lorenzo wants this to go? Reorganization, sale to someone else like a Carl Icahn, or is this just a gambit to get a little more time so that there is more room for negotiation?
We absolutely want to rebuild this airline. We believe we can bring it back.
You mean under the stewardship of Frank Lorenzo?
Under the stewardship of Phil Bakes and Frank Lorenzo.
Why? Why do you want to do it? I mean, clearly, his employees don't like him. That's readily apparent. So why does he want to go on with this airline? Why not just sell it?
Well, because first off, there's been nobody who's made a viable offer for the company, despite the fact that the unions have spent 3 years now. In fact, even under Frank Borman, they tried to find a purchaser for this company. We were the buyer of last resort in 86. And second, Lorenzo's history is that of an airline builder. Don't forget that when airline deregulation passed, he had 39 airplanes and less than 2,500 employees. Frank Lorenzo is dedicated to building airlines.
Charlie Bryan, this business of trying to find another buyer. Now, you've had conversations with Carl Icahn, and obviously what both Mr. Onstad and Frank Lorenzo himself have said today is that it's not enough to have a buyer. You've got to have a buyer who's willing to pay a reasonable price.
Well, first of all, I'd just like to talk about the airline builder comment. Frank Lorenzo, after he...
I'll tell you what, why don't you respond to my question first, and then if we've got time, we can get back to the other.
Well, I was going to work up to the response to the question. Yes, there absolutely has been meetings. Carl Icahn called me personally, said Frank Lorenzo gave him permission to do that back in September. We had a number of meetings. He did make offers. He's never lied to me. He's been very honest with me. He's a tough guy, a tough bargainer, but he at least has been honest and inform me about those talks. In fact, Frank Lorenzo himself initiated a phone call to me on October the 9th. He called me again on the 10th, said, I want to talk to you about your deal, what you keep talking about an airline acquisition by the employees. We had meetings. I went to Houston, had a three-hour meeting in Houston on the 18th of October. At that time, it was a very friendly and congenial meeting. I couldn't have written a script any better, Ted. And he said, I'd like to talk to you about your deal, employee ownership, and an ESOP. And for once, and for the first time, we actually had the door open so that we could make an offer. The reason I wanted to go back, quite frankly, is we had an investment banker with a confidence letter, and we offered $11.50 cash, considerably more than what Texas Air paid for Eastern in advance of the approval of the sale. But it was so close to the voting date for the shareholders meeting, the judge would not enjoin that shareholders meeting. But
I'll tell you what, I would like to get into that question of whether or not the employees might end up buying Eastern under the arrangement of what's happening right now. But let's take a break, and we'll continue our conversation in just a moment. Yes, again, I'd like to go back to Charles Bryan, however. Is it possible for this airline to be reorganized under Frank Lorenzo and for you folks to have a harmonious working relationship with him again? I mean, you've been through a lot of bitter strikes and a lot of bitter labor negotiations, and it always looks kind of bleak at one point or another. But is the well so thoroughly poisoned between you folks that it just can't work again?
Well, I had hopes from the meeting that I just mentioned to you in the last segment that that there might be an opportunity. I'm never an emotional, you know, guy with hate or anything like that. And I told Frank Lorenzo we'd be happy to work with him. Quite frankly, after he made those openings, we had two investment bankers with two different principals. He rejected all of that. He said he wouldn't talk to them after he promised to take those offers to the Texas Air Board. And the bitterness that started developing after that and his activities in bankrupting his company, when there's billionaires out there wanting to buy it, just didn't make any sense. And I think, yes, the well probably is poisoned at this point. Especially with the pilots and all the name-calling and accusations toward them. I think it is going to have to be done another way.
Captain Babbitt, does that also represent the view of the airline pilots?
To a great extent, yes. We hear a lot of flowery rhetoric about airline builders and substantial investments in Eastern Airlines. I've been here 22 years. There are 15,000 fewer employees here today at Eastern Airlines than there were 3 years ago. Eastern Airlines today generates almost $1.5 billion less in revenue than it did in 1986. That's clearly not a building process.
No, but that's exactly Frank Lorenzo's point. The point he's making is that because of the unions and the high rates that are being paid, that he's having to operate the airline at a loss. You're that making his point, aren't you?
No, sir. That makes a nice rhetorical statement, but the facts, if the revenue base was still here, this was right on the borderline of being a profitable corporation. The employees here have granted concessions in the past and are quite willing to do it now to save this airline. But not you cannot build an airline and continue to strip away the assets, the routes, the equipment, even the reservation system. We're having a very difficult time believing this rhetoric. Look across
Ted,
the street at Continental.
We need to straighten out some facts here, if we may.
Go ahead.
This was just called being on a borderline of being a profitable company. This is a company that lost $1.5 billion since 1978. It's made $65 million one time in the last 10 years. We've been talking about moving assets. You know, your opening segment said 20 airplanes went to Continental. Indeed, the net is two. The rest of the airplanes came back to Eastern. Your opening segment mentioned the Miami-London route. That was a route that Eastern had abandoned. It wasn't flying. There have been a lot of rhetoric on this show about stripping assets tonight, but indeed, you made the point at the opening of the session that this is an asset-rich company and a cash-poor company. If we had, in fact, sold more assets quicker, it wouldn't be in bankruptcy today. The problem is we, in fact, didn't sell enough assets quick enough to keep it alive, Ted.
Well, could I
comment on this remarks, Ted? It's unconscionable to allow that to go out over the airways. I was a member of Eastern's board of directors for over 2.5 years, and I know about the economics and finances of Eastern Airlines. And Eastern Airlines had the most profitable period in their entire history in the first 7 months of the year they sold it. $168 million in net profit in the first 7 months of that year, almost $300 million in operational profit. And by contrast, the only time Frank Lorenzo has been profitable at Continental was when he was working in bankruptcy, when he was protected from all the interest rates that the former judge commented on.
But Ted, Charlie was on the board of directors, Ted. Now, just a minute, Charlie. That's not fair either, because 6 months after you quoted that profit, that company had the bankruptcy lawyers on the ninth floor of that building the night that's right. 6 months after
there was
they
a conspiracy
million,
setting
the
it up to sell to Frank
lawyers
Lorenzo.
Were in that building. This Let airline me, faced bankruptcy three times in 9 years, Charlie.
Gentlemen, you've got to realize sometimes you folks end up talking in shorthand to one another because you know what you're talking about and the rest of us out of here don't. Let me ask Mr. Onstead one question, referring back to something that both Charlie Bryan and Captain Babbitt had to say. And that is the suggestion here that the well is so poisoned that you're not going to be able to, you're not going to be able to reach an agreement as long as Frank Lorenzo is chairman of that company.
I don't believe that. The issue is jobs. We got a sick company. We got to fix that company. And talking to Eastern Airlines employees, I believe that they like their company and they'll come back to work for that company. And what we got to do now is stop worrying about who struck John in the past and get on to building this company.
Gentlemen, we got one more segment to talk to one another. We'll continue in just a moment.
The creditors, who no one has mentioned here, so there's a lot more interest to be looked after, and the personalities will just have to go away for there to be a successful reorganization. After all, Chapter 11 is basically designed to be a compromise solution, not a litigated solution.
Mr. Bryan, was this a smart move for Frank Lorenzo, this filing Chapter 11?
I think it was a very bad move. If it had a cooperative relationship to either deal with us or let an arbitrator decide our contract or alternatively sell it, any of those in a cooperative way, it wouldn't have had all this damage to experience. And I would just say this, as it relates to the creditors and all of those people out there subject to risk and damage right now, we would certainly welcome them to take a look at the opportunity working with the employees as the best alternative instead of going down the path of destruction that they've seen happening in the past.
All right, Mr. Onstad, a final comment or two from you.
I would only say this, Ted, that it's unfortunate that, in fact, the unions have had a plan to force this company into bankruptcy for many, many months, indeed years. In fact, I testified to that and produced documents on Capitol Hill earlier this week. Indeed, the newspapers today show that they've exposed that plan. They intend to try to reach into the bankruptcy court and take the company away. But really, what we need to do is to come back to work, get this company up and flying, rather than fight it out in the bankruptcy court, Ted.
And from the pilot's point of view, Captain Babbitt?
Well, I couldn't agree more. We would certainly enjoy a process that would separate the adversarial issues here. But you've got to remember our point of view and who we're dealing with. We're dealing with a management at Continental. They've had, in the last 5 years, five new CEOs. So apparently no one is enjoying working over there. We have a great deal of difficulty signing. We're looking for professional security and a future with Eastern Airlines.
All right, gentlemen, I have to cut you off at that point. I'm deeply appreciative. I know what a long day it's been for all of you. Thank you very much for joining us. That's our report for tonight. I'm Ted Koppel in Washington. For all of us here at ABC News, good night.
This has been ABC News Nightline.
This has been a presentation of ABC News, where more Americans get their news than from any other source. ABC News voted best in the business by the Washington Journalism Review. Peter Jennings, Sam Donaldson, David Brinkley. No wonder ABC News is America's choice.
Yes, but my martini's still dry.
Sean Connery's the best Bond ever. Never say never again. Friendly discretion advised.
At day's end, the 60s are coming back, or at least one university sit-in sure makes it look that way.
And one symbol of the 60s joins us live to put the 80s in perspective.
And how are unruly grade school students in Ohio disciplined? It's a story we think you'll want to see, and it's all coming up as we rewind the day next at day's end.
Silly, love isn't silly at all.
Uh-huh.
Why do you keep Oscar?
We grew up together.
But he's so old.
There are some things you just don't give up.
Like your Johnson's baby powder?
Yeah, like my Johnson's baby powder. It's the softest there is. Don't you like how it makes my skin feel so smooth and soft?
Uh-huh.
Well, you wouldn't want to give that up.
Never.
Well, I'm not giving up Oscar.
Well, I guess there's some things you never outgrow.
The soft feeling of Johnson's baby powder, a feeling you never outgrow.
Crazy Like a Fox will continue.
This fall, Flip Wilson and Gladys Knight tackle the Modern Family.
When did we lose control of the kids?
Charlie, we'd never had it.
Charlie and Company, coming soon. Meet one unusual lady. Is she a nun? A cop?
We got it, we're rolling.
A doctor or a temptress?
What are you, some kind of mystery woman?
Yeah.
One smart detective knows the real truth. Will he tell the world or join in the fun? But time is running out.
We only have a half hour.
Story number one of the George Burns Comedy Week.
This is CBS.
Is threatening the fabric of some of America's clothes. The enemy is chlorine bleach, a liquid that can attack colors and delicate whites. But there is a bleach that is safe for all your colors, all your whites. Boratine bleach, the safe great white.
CTA crash investigation update at 10.